morning, and this is for both the presentation and the training for the pesticide grower position for surface water monitoring in the agriculture in urban areas in California. So I will introduce the theoretical considerations and then demonstrate the model program designed for this project. This project is organization work group in the surface water protection program of DPR. We would like to acknowledge our senior scientists and the managers and our scientific aides for their significant contribution in this project. So the outline is that I will start with the background and the previous studies and followed by the methodology. As you may already know, we have two phases in this project. Phase one, to generate a preliminary or initial priority list by considering only two parameters of pesticide use data and the toxicity data. And the phase two is to design to make a monitoring recommendations for each of those pesticides prioritized in the phase one with more variables. Then I will give a demonstration for the graphical user interface. So the demonstration will cover agricultural uses, urban uses, and watershed scale prioritization. I will also show some unique features by this program, including the regional and seasonal-based application prioritization, and also show the prioritization for the degraded toxicity. So as mentioned here, the methodology could be very complex, but I want to make sure the program is very easy to use. Here shows the reason and our approaches for the model development. This project is developed to answer some commonly asked questions for the monitoring project design. So for example, we have almost 1,000 different pesticides used in California, even and associated with even more degradates. But only a very small number of those pesticides and degradates are actually currently monitored by surface water program. And the other question is that we try to determine the region, the season, and the best pesticides to be monitored. So the project is developed based on the mathematical representations of the previous monitoring experiences by DPR surface water program. So it may be confusing, but the idea is that we surface water program already have a very nice experiences and ideas for the surface water monitoring. So we have some options or parameters or ideas to prioritize the pesticides in the surface water monitoring. But most of those ideas are presented in a descriptive format. So we try to define the scientific supporting and translate those ideas into a mathematical or numerical format so we can use that in the future prioritization purpose. So for example, we try to monitor pesticides with high toxicity and high runoff potential, but how to define the toxicity as high, how to define the runoff potential as high, those are questions we would like to answer. And of course, the purpose of this project is to support, justify, and improve the surface water monitoring project. And this project is not brand new. We already have some previous studies by surface water program. For example, in 2007, we have a report, assessment of acute aquatic toxicity of currently used pesticides in California with monitoring recommendations. So in this project, the author used the two major parameters, the pesticide use and toxicity, to generate the monitoring priority. So the conclusion is that there are five chemicals associated with high monitoring priority. So during the literature review, I'd like to create a basket to connect those very useful information from other studies. So for example, for this report, I found that at least the two parameters are very important for the prioritization, including the pesticide use and toxicity data. The other study in year 2009, a procedure for identifying pesticides with a high potential to contaminate surface water And in this study, they also used more factors in addition to the pesticide use and toxicity data. And those additional parameters include the for drinking water and human health. And the, of course, very important, the historic monitoring data. So this study came up with a list of 71 pesticides for surface water regulation. And actually, everyone in this room makes a significant contribution to this project by your registration evaluation, because the procedures for the evaluation and the prioritization are very similar. Those are designed to identify the potential risks to surface water. The only difference is that one, the registration evaluation is before the pesticide use in California, and the prioritization is for the post-use risk assessment. So, as you know, in the registration evaluation, we mainly use the toxicity data and also use the chemical probe and the label information. So we already have everything in the basket. It's time to design the study. We decided to have a two-phase study, including the phase one, which is designed to generate a preliminary priority list. Basically, it's a list of pesticides ordered by a parameter called the priority score, which is based on the pesticide use data and the aquatic toxicity data. And phase two is to refine the results in phase one. And we try to make a monitoring recommendations for each of those prioritized pesticides from the last phase based on more information such as the historic monitoring results, chemical probe, and the label information. And we also have a watershed scale prioritization of the byproduct or donors. So it's not a real next phase of the study, but just the implementation of the phase one and two with final spatial resolution. I want to mention that in the original design of phase one and phase two, and those prioritization are based on the PUR data aggregated in county level, because for urban pesticide uses, we only have the county level data. But for the watershed scale prioritization, it's based on a much, much finer resolution, which is at the section level, 1 by 1 mile. So the current version is only for agriculture, because urban doesn't have that kind of high resolution data. But actually, we are thinking about the urban PUR data downscaling, such as by considering the land use and population. So, before showing the mathematical part, I want to display the results from the phase one prioritization. So here is an example for the results for the statewide agriculture use annual usage during the 3 years of 2010 to 2012. So as you can imagine, there is a very long list that just shows the top 10 or more pesticides. So essentially, the result is a list of the pesticides ordered by the parameter called phyto score, which is the product of the use score and the toxicity score. So most of those data are straightforward. So for example, we have the chemical code and chemical name, the use data, annual use data in pound, and a use score defined from the use data. And the toxicity benchmark, the toxicity score based on the benchmark and the phyto score. The toxicity flag is a column reserved for the data source of the toxicity data. So essentially, we are trying to use the US EPA benchmark, but if there is additional data source can be used, we will give a flag here. So as you can see, the final score or the priority score is equal to the toxicity score times the use score. Toxicity score is the number from 1 to 8, and 1 for lower toxicity and 8 for higher toxicity. The classification is based on the lowest benchmarks of the sensitive species, including fishes and invertebrates. And actually, in the USDP benchmark, we also consider the aquatic plants. So the data source is including the USDPA OPP benchmark, and we also calculated the benchmark equivalence from the footprint pesticide property database by following exactly the same procedure and protocols we used for the USDPA benchmark calculation. So this table is for the definition of the toxicity scores. So as you can see, the very low toxicity of the score 1 is assigned to pesticides with the lowest benchmark value of larger than 1,000 ppb. And the most higher score of 8 is assigned to those with the toxicity value is less than 0.001. So who are on the top? There is only one chemical, which is associated with the highest number of 8, which is the gamma cephalosporin. So, but the advantage of this system is that in the future, we may have more pesticides associated with the, even higher toxicity. So in that case, we can just increase this number. And use score is from 1 to 5, 1 for lower use and 5 to, for the higher use. This system of 1 to 5 is originally designed based on our previous study back to 2007 and 2008. At that time, we have a classification system based on the statewide uses. So in that case, we can have some critical values as we used for the toxicity. But in this project, we try to incorporate the user-defined regions and seasons. So that means the fixed value for the classification is not really useful. So we develop another system based on the probability analysis. So first we develop a system with some predefined percentage or percentiles. So for example, if we have 100 pesticides, we want to assign 2 of them with a use score of 5 and 4% with 4 and so on. So here is the procedure. We calculated the pesticide use data for each of those pesticides and ordered the pesticide based on the use data. And then the top 2% of the pesticide will be assigned with the score of 5, and the next 4% will be assigned with the score of 4. So for example, again, we have only 100 pesticides, so the top 2 will be associated with the use score 5. And as mentioned here, those are default values in the model program, but there is an option in the interface, so the user can redefine those percentiles. So now we have both the toxicity score and the use score, and the phase 1 proteomics can be generated. And then we move to the next phase, phase 2, refined proteomics. So again, before showing the details, I want to show the results. And this is based on exactly the same priority settings as mentioned before, statewide agriculture, annual use is for 3 years. So the only difference is that there is one more column attached to the original phase 1 results. And this column is for the phase 2 monitoring recommendations. And only 2 values, true and false. True means that the model will recommend this chemical for monitoring, and false means the model will recommend the exclusion of this pesticide from monitoring. And by default, this is the recommendation for the parent AI, but there is an option in the program. We can also display the recommendations for the degraded. Yeah.
So how do you determine the recommendation? So what kind of criteria do you?
Yeah, that's the next slide. I said before I show you the details, I want to give you some idea about the results looks like. So the purpose or the objective of the phase 2 study is to identify pesticides with relatively high risk potential to surface water and also make the marketing recommendations. So basically, because we already have the phase 1 priority list, we can just select the top pesticides from that list. And for sure, those pesticides will be associated with high use and high toxicity. But with the high use and high toxicity, that doesn't mean the pesticide will be associated with relatively high risk potential to surface water. So we try to do something to refine the results. Suppose we can have some procedure to identify or classify the pesticides into a high risk to surface water and a low risk to surface water. And for the monitoring purpose, we try to capture those high risk pesticides as much as possible and try to avoid those low-risk pesticides as much as possible to use our resources more efficiently. So, but by compared to our current monitoring status, we found some differences. So as you can see, there are some high-risk pesticides are not really monitored, and there are some low-risk pesticides are monitored in our current project. So with more details, there are four sections. For section one and three, those are what we really want. So the high-risk pesticides are monitored, or the low-risk pesticides are not monitored. But for the region two and region four, there are some problems. So that means we have a very specific purpose or objective in the phase two, which is to minimize this region, region two, and minimize the region four. In other words, we try to maximize the region one and region three. So unlike the phase one development, phase two is started with manual investigation on selected pesticides. We call that a screening justification, which is mainly conducted by April, Mike, and Rob. So we selected some phase one top pesticides, but not really monitored by certain waterproof ones, and have a very comprehensive analysis on their label, use, toxicity, chemical property, and the historical monitoring results, and try to define and identify some parameters which can be used to explain our monitoring decisions. So basically, there are two decisions. One is that this chemical is actually associated with the low risk potential to surface water, so we don't care about that and just exclude that from the monitoring. And the other decision could be that this chemical is actually associated with the potential surface water problem, so we may consider to include that into the surface water monitoring in the future. So here shows the example and prepared by Mike for the aquarium. So as the author said, the reason to exclude is that there are multiple parameters, for example, including the low persistence in water and something related to application method and the holding period compared to the aquatic half-life and the low persistence in soil and the decreasing usage. More information are available in our internal shared drive. Actually, those reports are really good. It's provide even more information compared to a regular usage paper. So once we have those screening justification, we have a group meeting to determine some commonly identified factors which can be used in our project. So finally, we have the following factors or the group of factors, including the use pattern, application method, monitoring results, and of course the chemical problem. So next step is to translate those factors into a mathematical format. So for example, for the monitoring results, we defined the high observed water persistence if the 99.9 percentile of the measured concentration is higher than the lowest benchmark. And for the application method, we defined the high-risk application methods including spray chemization, water application, broadcast, or turf treatment. Those are not only a description, but also exactly the same definition we use in the PUR database. So we can just get information exactly from that database. And for the chemical property, for example, we have a high mobility in water designation, which is defined by the KOC nitrogen 4000. And so in summary, we have 16 variables as summarized in the document. And the development of those variables are mainly based on our registration evaluation model and the footprint passes at the probing databases. We have so many data used in the program. So I think we have the most comprehensive databases for the monitoring data, including three major databases in the world for the California. I mean, the DPR database, the USGS National Water Information System, and the database by Water Board. And for the pesticide use and the product information, of course, we use the PUR data. and toxicity data, including the those used by phase one fluorotization. We also include the toxicity data for degradates, which is based on the footprint database. And we also included the USDB drinking water standards and the USDB human health benchmark. And for the chemical property, we mainly based on the footprint database for both the degradates and the parents. And I'll show you before the results is just one additional column attached to the phase one results, including two recommendations. Two means that the test is that potentially cause a surface water problem, and we should include that into the monitoring, and fourth for the exclusion. And there is another output file for the reason to include or exclude a pesticide. And here shows the flow chart, and I summarized basically the step-by-step procedure for the evaluation. For example, the first question is that there is any sufficient monitoring data, yes, go this way and no, go that way. So basically we have three groups of evaluation based on the monitoring data, the use pattern and application method, and finally the chemical properties. So this is basically everything for the modeling part. But I would like to continue the presentation for the next part called finalization of a list for the pesticides to be monitored in your project. So here we will consider some professional justification. And so the final list of the pesticides for a specific monitoring study or a monitoring site will be based on, of course, the model-based recommendation. And also some additional considerations which may not be considered by the model. So as shown here, we get the model results, and we just retrieve the top pesticides from faithful results, and then we will consider the set specific considerations which could be used to exclude some of those pesticides from the model results. And of course, we should check the availability of the analytical methods. In addition to that, at the final stage, monitoring project PI may have some professional judgment to include more pesticides, which is beyond the modeling results. The reason for the additional considerations is because, at first, the model is not perfect. We try to include more and more information and considerations, but there must be something missed in the model. And there is a built-in limitation, especially for the spatial resolution. Because for monitoring, we are actually talking about one point. But for the prioritization, it's usually used data which is aggregated for a region, such as one county or one watershed. And the next one is for the different scope, objectives, and resource for specific project. I have a good example for that. For example, if we just based on the modeling results, we may have to monitor the OP pesticides in the San Martin Valley, but actually we didn't do that. That's because we believe that part has been significantly covered by other agencies and other programs. So we have our own focus for the monitoring. And last, the flexibility by the project PI. So the PI may have their own experiences and understanding on the project. So it's totally fine to add more pesticides out of the model results. So I also suggested some general procedures to use the modeling results. And first, I suggested that there is an estimation of the total number of pesticides to be monitored based on the project design and, of course, the budget. For example, I want to measure 20 different pesticides in my project. And then we will run the model and retrieve the top recommended pesticides according to this number. So we may shoot 20 or slightly more than that because of the consideration of the analytical method. So finally, there are some adjustments by removing some of those model recommended pesticides and adding more from outside of the modeling results. But anyway, we should also document the reason, the justification for those modifications. So finally, as a modeler, I have my expectations. That is, the model may explain majority of the final list in the monitoring. So those person can be actually calculated based on the regions I mentioned before. So there are four regions. I said the phase two objective is to minimize the region two and region four and maximize region one and region three. So this can be calculated based on that diagram. So validation, and here shows the modeling results and the currently monitored approach, monitored pesticides in our monitoring project. So this is for the urban and rest of the application in Sacramento County and the Placer County during the 3 years of 2010 and 2012. So top 20 results are displayed here, and the pesticides are highlighted for according to the monitoring study protocol prepared by Mike. So as you can see, for most of those true pesticides are actually currently modeled, monitored by our program. And more important, those four chemicals are actually excluded in the monitoring project, which is a good sign. The next one is for agriculture, and this is agriculture uses for the Imperial County for the same period of the PUR data. And again, the highlighted pesticides are taken from the study prepared by Shin. So there is one thing I want to mention is that there is one chemical which is not really recommended by the model, but actually monitored in the project. So this triggers more discussion and investigation on this specific chemical, the chlorine xenonil. So based on the personal communication with Shin, he agreed that maybe in the future this chemical could be excluded from his study. So this is a good example of how the model can be used to improve our monitoring project design. And so before the demonstration, I'd like to show those bigger pictures of the model interface, because the real program is smaller, especially for those from the high conference. So there are three sections or tabs in the program. The first one is some basic information, such as the use pattern for agriculture, urban, rest of way, or their combination. Rest of way is separated because it's very difficult to separate the agricultural rest of way and urban rest of way. So I have a natural option for that. And of course, the PUR data, so which is your PUR data you want to use for your prioritization and processing data, including many options. And of course, we have the USDP benchmark is required and built in. And then we can select the acute toxicity or chronic toxicity for different toxicity databases, including the benchmark equivalent from the footprint and the similar one for from the footprint for the degradation. And as mentioned before, we have the drinking water and the human health benchmarks. Then the next one is to for more options. So basically, by default, this program will have the prioritization for statewide and annual PUR data. And here we can have more options for the county or region-based prioritization by defining the counting codes. And of course, for the month and the season-based prioritization based on the months of the user input. And this is the option to change the percentiles used in the pesticide use score. So as mentioned before, we have a predefined set such as 2%, 4%, and so on. But now there is the option to change that by a specific user. And this one is used to exclude chemicals without toxicity data to simplify your final results. And this option is to simplify the output. So for example, we may only interested in the top 15 chemicals, but you can change that to 1,000. And this is to reset it to the default settings, means that we want to reset it to the statewide and annual prioritization. And this is very useful for the data updating. So if there is a new data of PUR or there is a significant update, we try to download the data from our internal database. This is this version is only for the internal data downloading. But I'm thinking about another option for the outside users to import the PUR data published online. Next one is for the watershed. So basically, the phase one and phase two are originally designed for counting, but there is no any problem to achieve watershed. So the only thing is find monitoring sites, and the program will automatically retrieve the information for the upstream drainage areas. And I have another function called a continuous, especially continuous mapping. The difference is that for most of the prioritization, we are talking about one monitoring site or one group of the monitoring sites. But this one is to actually give a spatial variability of the monitoring priority for individual chemicals over the entire California. And this one is not really finalized and not included in the posted document. But I think there should be any significant change to the phase one and the phase two, because basically they are in the same procedure. And the first demonstration is a very simple test. So actually, we may get a chance to look into the results. So it's a statewide prioritization for agricultural use based on the annual data of 2012. So the toxicity statement data will be based on the acute aquatic benchmarks for the parent AI only. So before open the program, there is a message for the database information and give you more information about the data actually in the local database. So as you can see, in this database, we already have the data downloaded and formatted for the 4 years. This is very important because we want to make sure the data we used in the prioritization is actually available in the local database. So it's called a simple test because basically it's everything is just a default value. For example, the statewide, so we won't change anything about the region and season. And agriculture is already checked here. And the acute aquatic toxicity for the USDP benchmark and its benchmark equivalent. So we just click the button of the prioritize. It takes about 10 seconds, but in this small computer may take a little bit longer. So we just go ahead for the results. So I have shown this result before. So again, here is the result for the phase one and also the phase two. And of course, we are really interested in those. Okay. This is already done. And the results will be printed in a web page format, so everyone can just use that without any additional requirement for the software. So as shown here is some detailed information for both the priority list, so you can download the data in an Excel format. And also there is, as I mentioned before, there is a phase two load for detailed information of the recommendations. So you can just open that. And after that, there's information for the program, the version, and of course the use data agriculture, excluding rest of the application, and the years of PUR data used in this particular prioritization. And this is very important of the PUR data version, because there are sometimes there are some updates for PUR data which is not really notified publicly. So sometimes if you found your prioritization results is different from others, that may be the problem of your PUR data version. And the toxicity data, and here shows some detailed information for the use score that I mentioned. So as I mentioned before, 2% of the total chemicals will be assigned for the highest score, use score of 5, and the next 4% for the score of 4. So
let's go back to the PowerPoint.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, for the recommendation. So we found two chemicals with the monitoring recommendation of false. So the reason or the reason to exclude the pesticide is with two loads. So shown here, for most of those chemicals of exclusion are associated with the short persistence in water. And we can maybe we can find some other reasons. Example here, the low bioavailability in new water system. And here, the no soil runoff potential. So this is the first and we already showed that. The second one for urban, and I will show the regional and the seasonal prioritization. So for this demonstration, it's based on the urban use, urban and rest of wind pesticide applications in the Orange County during some specific months for the 2010 to 2012. And in addition to the parent AI toxicity, we will also check the toxicity for the degradates. So again, go back to the program, and first thing is to make sure the Orange County is enacted. So we uncheck this default settings and use the counting region-based prioritization and select the county of Orange. And then, of course, we are not really use the annual-based prioritization, but only for some specific months. So I just attack the months here from May to October. And it's Orange County. Next thing is to change the use pattern. It's not agriculture anymore. It's urban use and include the rest of wheat. So for the toxicity data, because it's designed for both the parents and degradates, we have to check the option for the degradates benchmark equivalent and to do the prioritization. So again, I just show the results while we are waiting for the program. So I mentioned before, the, by checking the option of the degradates, we have the phase two recommendation for not only the AI, but also for the degradates. Okay. Much faster than I expected.
And so, also check the detailed information on triclopyr.
Yes.
It has two falses, and we detect high frequency.
Okay. Yeah, this is a note for the urban demonstration. So the first thing I want to mention about the degradates. As you can see, the program that the following degradates for this chemical may be included for the monitoring, including the including two degradates. And of course, there are more degradates included in our monitoring project. The reason is that this is based on only the footprint database. So that means if the data is not available in that database, it won't show up in the program. So if you have a better database for the toxicity of the degradates toxicity better than the footprint just in the middle, I really want to incorporate more information for the degradates. So which chemical might
be? Triclopyr. Maybe it's just talk based on toxicity. Both false and false on your aspect there. Oh, true and then false.
True and, yeah, that means the degradates is.
Oh, false. Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Hey, well, let me take it off the screen anyway. So. That's where it comes.
Okay.
So, yes. Yeah. Supernode does have degradates on the OPP benchmark.
Yeah. Actually, I'm looking for a more formatted database rather than get one from this source and get one from another literature review. So if you know there is any place we can find a better
database rather than our individual values, we can turn to that database. But it's fine to manually add different options or values into the program. This one is the watershed scale prioritization. So the example is the drainage area of a specific monitoring site of Salinas River and the Dial Mountain Road are defined by Xin in his study protocol. So there are some additional parameters we have to define before the watershed scale prioritization. So the first thing, there is a manual georeference of this specific site into a USGS-defined watershed. So for example, this monitoring site is actually located in this USGS watershed. It's called a 12-digit hydrological unit code. And there, in addition to that, there is a very important thing to determine if the site is actually located on the mainstream or on a local tributary. Because if it's located on the mainstream, that means the prioritization will consider not only this specific watershed, but also the entire drainage basin. So for this site, it's actually located in the mainstream, so we check it. And the settings is similar to our we used before agriculture and any data for 3 years. So the magic of this watershed prioritization is that the use data is not only for the watershed enclosed monitoring set, but also the entire drainage basin, which may cross multiple countries. There are actually 131 watersheds in for this specific site. So, demonstration. So in this case, we back to agriculture because mentioned before, watershed is not really for urban at this time. And we may just uncheck the degradates to save more time. And back to the default and watershed. Here I have some predefined monitoring sites, mainly based on the Xin study, the study 290. But you can actually do the manual definition for each of your own monitoring station. So in this case, I just selected the Salinas River and the Dell Mountain Road. And this, because it's predefined, so the USGS watershed code and the and mainstream option will be selected automatically. So it doesn't matter use the predefined or manual defined. So we started the floor size. Okay, yeah, let's just go ahead for the next one for the spatially continuous mapping. So the idea is that before, for most of our prioritization, it's mainly about one station, one monitoring site, and to check the relative priority for multiple chemicals. But the spatially continuous mapping is designed for individual pesticides over the entire California. So here is the results, and I don't have more information to see, but just here. So the region is for the specific monitoring station. And again, so here is the example for the California files. The priority score is selected slightly different as we used in phase one. So here I use the cumulative use and the cumulative the drainage area and divided by the toxicity. So the cumulative use means that it's not only for the watershed enclosing the monitoring set, but also including the entire upstream drainage areas. So the result is actually not on a GIS format, but we have to do some manual post process. So there are two results, one for the tributaries and the other one for the mainstream. As you can see, of course, for the tributaries, we get a higher concentration, higher score. And we also identify some hot spots, such as the West San Joaquin, the Salinas River valleys, and the interior. So if you are not a management PI, it's not a problem. This program can be also very useful. For example, it could be a tool for quick PUR query. For example, if there is some very very complex query asked by other people, you can use this tool to do a very easy query. And in addition to that, there is a compiled toxicity database, not only for the aquatic toxicity, but also for the drinking water, human health, for both the acute and chronic parents and degraded. And that we also have the chemical properties for hundreds of pesticides, which is formatted and updated from the footprint database. And after, I believe we have the most comprehensive monitoring data for pesticides in California by including those three major databases. Actually, you may say that you just want to download this data by yourself, but the major advantage is that our database are all indexed by chemicode. We spend a lot of time to do that because different databases may have different the naming and coding system. Sometimes we found some slight difference between the chemical names and even for the case number. So by indexing with the only one index of a chemical should be really helpful. So because this project has been intensively reviewed for the last 2 or 3 years, so there are some commonly asked questions. So the first one, and for one pesticide, its use score may change from one termination to another, and why not use the fixed value for the classification? So the answer is that it's true that the use score may be changed for different locations, different regions, and different seasons. We don't use the fixed value mainly because we try to have the flexibility to select different regions and seasons rather than just a statewide prioritization. The next one, the use data not covered by PUR. We don't use don't consider any data which is not considered by PUR, such as the indoor use, homeowner, application, and surfactant. So I think the idea is that we try to do the prioritization based on the data available in PUR rather than give an exact prediction of the water concentration in a river. So we think it's totally fine to use that as the index. And how about to include more databases such as the ecotoxicity or saltwater species? And this part we are pretty confident because actually the surface water program participated in the US EPA benchmark development. So in the future, the final objective is that we will only use the US EPA benchmark after our significant contribution to that part of the database. So for the saltwater species, I think we should discuss that with US EPA. If the US EPA benchmark select to include that, we have no problem. So the next one, the relative runoff potentials for different crops, use and soil, weather, hydrology conditions, those are not really included in phase one and phase two, but maybe a direction for our future studies. The connection with the surface water registration evaluation. Actually, there are some connections. For example, we have a watch list for the conditionally supported pesticides. So in that case, we may have some tracking system to track the new AI, which is in the watch list, and incorporate that into the prioritization program. And the availability. The model is currently in DPR internal shared drive, so everyone within DPR can use that. For outside people, we are thinking about the release to the public soon.